Hey everyone, it's Bea. In the last couple of lessons, we've learned about two important categories of macromolecules in living things, carbohydrates and lipids. Today, we will explore a third category of macromolecules, proteins. You may have heard that protein helps us build and maintain muscle mass, and that's true, but proteins also do much, much more. In fact, it's hard to find a process in living things that does not involve proteins. Let's take a closer look to see what these very important molecules are all about. By the end of this lesson, you'll be able to characterize proteins, describe how some proteins serve as enzymes, and explain additional roles that proteins play in organisms. At this point, if I asked you to guess which elements make up proteins, I bet you'd have a pretty good idea. If you said carbon, hydrogen, and oxygen, you are correct. As with carbohydrates and lipids, carbon atoms form the backbone of proteins, so they are organic molecules. In addition to carbon, hydrogen, and oxygen, proteins contain nitrogen, shown in models as blue. Some proteins contain additional elements as well. This is a model of a hemoglobin molecule, a protein we'll explore in more detail shortly. Besides all of the carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, and nitrogen atoms, does anything else stand out about this molecule overall? It's huge! One hemoglobin contains more than 10,000 atoms. Not all proteins are this large, but many are, so we'll model them without showing the bonds. The atoms in this model look like they're all squished together, but know that they are in fact bonded, just like in carbohydrates and lipids. And because proteins are such large, complex molecules, they're sometimes represented using simplified models called ribbon diagrams. Ribbon diagrams show the overall folding shape of the protein using ribbons, without showing the individual atoms. Both of these models represent a hemoglobin protein. It may look like a messy, randomly shaped molecule, but in fact, the atoms are arranged in a very particular order, giving the protein the exact folded shape it needs to do its particular job. Proteins are assembled from smaller molecules linked together called amino acids. All the proteins in our bodies are built from just 21 different amino acids. Notice how all the amino acids have a piece which is the same, containing carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, and nitrogen. However, the remaining portions of the molecules differ. Some are chains, some are rings, some contain a sulfur or selenium atom. Additionally, some amino acids are polar and others are not. We've already seen how important polarity is in determining a molecule's properties, so which amino acids are included in a protein in which order determines everything about the protein, including the shape it will fold into and how it will interact with other molecules. Our bodies can produce some of these amino acids we need for protein construction. However, our bodies are unable to produce these 9 amino acids. Therefore, they are called essential amino acids. We must consume them in our food so our bodies can use them to produce proteins. Foods which contain some or all of these essential amino acids include nuts, beans, lentils, eggs, and whole grains. Eating a variety of these healthy foods ensures that you get all of the amino acids you need, in addition providing healthy carbohydrates and lipids. There are many thousands of different proteins in our bodies, but they are all made from the same 21 building blocks. How do amino acids get linked together in just the right order to build all proteins we need to survive? That is the purpose of DNA. DNA is coded instructions which tell our cells how to assemble amino acids into proteins. We'll learn more about how this amazing process works in Unit 5. Okay, so proteins are large organic molecules made of amino acids linked together. But what do proteins do? Unlike many carbohydrates and lipids, the primary function of proteins is not to be an energy source or energy storage. However, proteins serve a wide variety of other critical roles in organisms. Let's take a look at some of those roles, beginning with enzymes. Do you remember what happens in a chemical reaction? In a chemical reaction, bonds between atoms break, new bonds form, or both. In other words, atoms and molecules get rearranged to form new substances. Life depends on continuous chemical reactions to store energy, release energy, digest food, build new tissue, remove waste, and more. Our bodies are giant chemical reaction machines. But many of the chemical reactions we depend on wouldn't happen on their own, at least not as quickly as we need them to. Chemical reactions can be sped up by substances called catalysts. A catalyst increases the rate of a chemical reaction. Some proteins act as catalysts inside living things. These biological catalysts are called enzymes. So, how do enzymes actually work? Let's look at an example of a reaction in our bodies which relies on an enzyme. Do you remember what sucrose is? Sucrose is table sugar. More specifically, sucrose is a disaccharide. It consists of two monosaccharides, glucose and fructose, linked together. We can use polygons to represent the two monosaccharide rings in a simplified way. Our bodies can use glucose and fructose for energy, but only after sucrose is broken apart through a chemical reaction. This is where an enzyme called sucrase comes in. Sucrase is a protein, specifically an enzyme, which helps break sucrose into glucose and fructose. Sucrase is represented here as a blue blob, but in reality, it is a complex molecule. Like all enzymes, sucrase has an active site, a location on the molecule where the reactants of a chemical reaction can attach. The reactants that attach to an enzyme are called substrates. In this case, there is only one substrate, sucrose. The active site is shaped just right so its specific substrate will fit, like a hand in a glove. The active site on sucrase is perfectly shaped to hold on to sucrose and help the bond between glucose and fructose break more easily. The separated products are then released from the enzyme. Notice how the enzyme is the same before and after the reaction. Enzymes aren't used up during the reactions they assist with. They're available to help speed up reactions over and over again. Another sucrose molecule will soon attach to the sucrase enzyme, and the process will repeat. Sucrase is just one of many enzymes in our bodies that enables digestion. Another example is amylase, which is present in our saliva. Both of these models show amylase, one in atom form and the other in ribbon form. And what does this enzyme do? Amylase helps break down starch. Remember that starch is a carbohydrate, specifically a polysaccharide that plants make by linking lots of glucose rings together. Starch has two components with different structures, amylose and amylopectin, but both are made of glucose rings. And both need to be broken down into simpler sugars before our bodies can use the glucose for energy. As we chew a food containing starch, amylase in our saliva begins breaking the starch down into simple sugars. Those sugars will be further broken down by additional enzymes through the digestive tract. Starch is not the only polysaccharide produced by plants that we consume in our food. Do you remember the other one? It's cellulose, which is also made of glucose rings, but has a straight shape rather than a branching shape like starch. Cellulose requires a different enzyme, cellulase, to be broken down. Humans do not have the cellulase enzyme, which is why we cannot break down cellulose. But remember, cellulose is still valuable to us because it acts as a fiber. Termites, on the other hand, do have cellulase, which allows them to digest wood made of cellulose. And it's not just carbohydrates that get broken down with the help of enzymes. The fats we eat are broken down into fatty acids by lipase enzymes. Similarly, proteins we consume are broken down into amino acids by various enzymes. That means proteins are broken down by other proteins. After enzymes break macromolecules down into their building blocks, our bodies use the smaller molecules for energy or to build new macromolecules. Not all enzymes are involved in digestion, though, nor do all enzymes break molecules down into smaller molecules. Some enzymes help smaller molecules combine into larger ones. For example, an enzyme called DNA polymerase helps build new DNA strands when DNA is being copied. We'll learn more about how this enzyme works in Unit 5. By the way, did you notice a pattern in the enzymes' names? Most enzymes' names end in ase, and the beginning of their names usually relates to the molecule they break down or build. Sucrase breaks down sucrose. Lipase breaks down lipids, and so on. There are thousands of different enzyme types in the human body which keep us alive. But not all proteins are enzymes. Proteins serve many other roles in organisms as well. Let's look at some additional examples of proteins to learn more about the many important jobs these macromolecules have. We'll start our tour with hemoglobin, a protein in our red blood cells. Hemoglobin has the critical job of transporting oxygen from our lungs to the rest of our bodies. Cells die if they are deprived of oxygen for too long. Hemoglobin's ability to transport oxygen comes from heme molecules. Heme is not built from amino acids like the rest of the hemoglobin molecule, but four heme molecules are tightly incorporated into the protein's structure, highlighted in pink. You may have heard that iron is important for our blood, and that's true because each heme group contains a single iron atom in the middle. And even though there are only four iron atoms out of more than 10,000 atoms in a hemoglobin molecule, they are very important. When blood travels through the lungs, inhaled oxygen gas attaches to the four iron atoms in hemoglobin proteins. Hemoglobin travels in red blood cells to the rest of the body, where the oxygen is dropped off to all the cells that need it. The hemoglobin then returns to the lungs, where it picks up more oxygen. Hemoglobin is just one of the many proteins that transport materials in organisms. Other proteins serve structural roles in living things. One example is collagen, the most abundant protein in our bodies. Collagen molecules have a long, spiraled shape, which allows them to combine with other collagen molecules to form fibers. This structure makes collagen the perfect structural protein in connective tissues like tendons and ligaments. Collagen also adds strength and elasticity to our skin. Another structural protein is keratin. Like collagen, keratin has a long structure which allows it to join together to form tough fibers. Keratin fibers combine to form our hair and nails, and humans aren't the only animals who depend on keratin for structure. Claws, hooves, and feathers are also made of keratin. And proteins do more than give our bodies structure. They help our bodies move too. Muscle tissue is a combination of different proteins arranged into fibers. Two of these proteins are actin and myosin. Actin is shown here in orange and myosin in green. These two proteins work together to make muscles contract. Let's look at a simplified model of these two proteins to understand how they work. When a muscle receives a signal telling it to contract, myosin heads, highlighted on the diagram, grab onto actin molecules and pull them inwards. Then the myosin heads detach and pull again, repeating the process to shorten the muscle. The interaction between actin and myosin is similar to moving a rope towards you by pulling with one hand, then the other, just at the molecular level. Lots of microscopic myosin proteins pulling on actin proteins causes an entire muscle to contract. To relax the muscle, actin returns to its original extended state, and the muscle lengthens. Wow! Proteins have all sorts of important roles. In this lesson, we've only scratched the surface of the many functions that proteins serve. They are a very complex and diverse group of macromolecules. We'll see many more examples of proteins as we move through the course. Life couldn't exist without them. We now know that proteins are made from amino acids linked together and are often large molecules. Some proteins serve as enzymes which speed up chemical reactions in organisms. And other proteins work to transport materials, provide structure, allow for movement, and more. Congratulations! You made it through all of the Unit 2 topics. Next time, you'll have a chance to review what you've learned before completing the final assessment for Unit 2. Until then, remember, biology is more than just science. It's the way of life. See you next time. Hey, hey.